inspire their children. Children ask questions. Subconsciously, it has an effect. When you have things, when people walk in your house, they should know that they walk into an African-American home. That's what the things that we wanted to provide. But it had to be done in a way where we could satisfy everyone. I knew the demographics in Los Angeles and the need. I understood it nationwide. But coming out of a corporate environment, I understood the practicalities. I was a marketeer. I was a capitalist. Okay, it just happens to be black. And I knew the importance, but a lot of things had to do with education. We had to educate. We had to tell people, this is a poster, this is a limited edition. And so we went about doing that in a pragmatic way. Okay, and one thing just led to the other. Then we started doing, I mean, this whole thing about moving art on the streets. I learned how to hustle the artwork on the streets in Los Angeles, in Hollywood. And we went as far as Orange County, where blacks were not known to go. And we did that too. So that whole thing, I mean, you have to understand that it was so vitally important. It's not saying artists wanted to do something because they were just about themselves. We were charged with a responsibility to represent a whole nation of black people that, tell you, it wasn't happening up until the 60s. So that whole dynamic became part of our lives. And then we found out that there were artists all over the country. Then we started going to Atlanta. We started going to Washington, D.C., Kansas City. And when I was just into this thing, it became so profound and so demanding that we could barely keep up with it. You know, it was probably the most gratifying part of my life when I was able to service my people in that way. And the rest is history. I mean, we planted seeds that would last a lifetime. And I just thank God for that opportunity to be around as an artist during that time. We call the 90s the golden age of African American art. We learn how to be self-validating artists. For a long time, you had to be validated, either by an educational institution, but we got out there in the streets and validated ourselves. Okay? And because of that, most people understood that. Now, you can call it a hustle or whatever you want to call it, a street hustle, but it was one of those hustles that was culturally necessary and viable. And that's why we did it.
Just like jazz, born out of its own struggle, the three of us. For me, I had a dilemma. When I got into the art world, I came through a couple of galleries, Spiral Gallery in Brooklyn with James Denmark. I was with Art O'Neill. These cats are fine artists. Went to school. So I cut my little teeth there, and then I got picked up to add to what, you know, my colleagues are talking about. I got picked up. The thing that really helped put my name and our names out there probably was Things Graphic and Fine Art, an African American publishing and distribution company. And from we licensed our images, 8 images to start. Posters, and from the African American art community, we opened up jobs and businesses that, like, for instance, there were many frame shops and galleries that were open all over the country because of what we were doing, because of Things Graphic Distribution. Things Graphic Distribution was so huge that the time it took for Bearden and Lawrence to be popular, it took us that in light speed. I mean, like that. Not only that, we created, what's the name of the group? Not the, the Tupperware type group. What's it called? Personal Preference. These were African American women deliberately purchasing collections of prints and having house parties. I mean, we were, there was an insatiable appetite for our self-expression, our culture, and who we are. That these Tupperware parties made it possible to cultivate our collectors and people who followed us up until this very second. We are, with the first time when I licensed my work with Things Graphic, I just told you this, okay, I'll take the dollar, you know, on each one, you know, whatever. And then I turned on the TV one night, just took a break, and the Martin Show just came on, came out. And all of a sudden I see Martin and Gina goes inside the bedroom. And there on my on the wall, one of Things Graphic, one of my images, Bob, Leroy Campbell. I said, oh my God, that's my shit! And I say, what does this mean? All of a sudden the phone started ringing. People from Charleston, hey boy, don't think we ain't got no TV down. Yeah man, we see you boy, you made it. And it's like, oh my God, so my work, my name became household from the Martin Show. Then it got picked up, put on the First Wives Club. Heat of the Night. So that marketing just made it, and at this time, I'm still dealing with galleries and the three of us. Now, these guys are my mentors. They don't, these two right here? I mean, these guys were teaching me how to do it for self. Because they were, I hadn't been doing it for myself then, but they had. They had been seriously marketing the work. I went visit him for a weekend and just warehouse, beautiful. I mean, they were doing it. Self-employed and making accessible culture and cultivating. So when I saw that, I said, wow, that's what I want to do. Meanwhile, I'm working at the hospital and I'm a single parent, two kids. So, but all of a sudden, I'm like, my name is spreading around through this distribution. So I decided to produce my own one-man show. I rented a gallery in Soho. I went and studied how to do it. I had about 50 pieces. I opened the show. I took a leave of absence. On the day of the show, the job sent me a letter saying, if you don't return today, you're fired. Wow. I had never lost a job. So I had to, I'm the only one with the key. So I had to open the show, open the door, let in the band, I let in the caterer, and I'm like, oh my God, am I gonna lose my job? So I turned away from the artwork and faced the blank wall. I said, God, what do you want me to do? And a calm came over me. Yeah. I went on for the rest of the night. Yeah. 800 people showed up.
Wow.
Including Phyllis Hyman. By the end of the night, I God is my witness, I made $50,000. Wow. I never looked back. I took that money and I started investing in becoming a distributor and publisher of my own work, just like how these gentlemen were doing. So I don't believe in the starving artist concept. I think it's overrated. I think that when God gives you a path and a gift that you're supposed to be on, it's not an accident, you're supposed to follow that. So here it is today, you know, the business aspect of it, you know, it's been successful. We're still, it's interesting though, because even during the 80s when Clinton was in office, holy man. We were selling so much work. Okay?
Yeah, we weren't ready for it.
We weren't ready for it, right? But now, check it out. We love painting. When we sit down to paint, neither one of these guys, including myself, are thinking about money. We love what we do. We also feed on the culture of our work. But once we finish and put a signature on it, we know how to make a commodity out of it and how to make sure we package it and respect the different levels of it. And that's our story. So here we are now looking at people who are still buying artwork, and even in this particular period, it seems like whenever things are going in a struggle, more and more people desire more art. That's an interesting segue. Why is that? Why do you think that is?
I think that nothing is new. It's always been that way. But when you have an awakening, then you become sensitized to certain things. So even though we were late in being sensitized, it's always been that way. Art has always had that allure. It's used to document our culture, our history, and everything. But we were so far removed from it, we didn't get a chance to view it from that perspective. And this new renaissance allowed us to connect in a way that many other cultures had already connected. And so, you know, if you can walk through the hall here and not be moved by one piece, I will personally buy your shovel and your plot. Because something's wrong. That means you are that disconnected from the essence of why we're here. We're not here because we decided that we were the best men on planet painting. And most of us, you won't even hear us talk about our art when we're not doing this, okay? But the important piece is, now that you are sensitized, what are you gonna do with that, okay? If you talk about the 80s to the 90s, he was right. This thing was happening so fast, most of us didn't know what to do, money was falling out of our pockets, we just...
Trying to catch up?
Trying to keep up with it, it was moving so fast, you know? And then you get to the 9/11, it crashed. You're talking about the stock market, the banking industry, everything crashed. So what crashes with that? When your disposable income is gone, you focus on the house. So that means all the galleries that we had been fortifying through that period of time, most of the mom-pop galleries crashed. And whoever didn't make the adjustment for technology with the internet and such, those businesses folded also. So we're in another revolution again. And it's technological now. Because when we were doing all of this hustling and grinding, there was no internet. There was no social network. And now we get that. That's what we feed off of now. You know, I had one guy ask me, he was being a skeptic. He says, well, is your work in any museums? And I said, well, no work is not in any museums. He says, well, you know, then you really haven't made it until you work in a museum. And I looked at him in the square of his face and said, my work is in 350,000 homes. I would rather my work be in 350,000 homes than one museum. That's a different mindset altogether. Because again, remember, no matter how sophisticated you are in this audience, it wasn't designed for you to participate. That's the biggest key. That's why this is important. And while you're talking, there are revolutions happening even right now. Do you know how difficult it is for artists to show their work even on a cruise ship? If you don't know, start watching. This is one of the first times that we have been able to really dominate the hallways with our artwork. Because people are pressing all the time to make sure you guys have access to this. So when you walk down the hall and you're just used to seeing it, that's fine. You know, at least enlighten your brothers and sisters so they can know what's happening. Because I'm going to tell you what's happening to us right now. When we started into this game, everybody was starving and hungry for their culture. Everybody. Mm-hmm. 25 years now has passed since then. So that it means there's a generation coming behind that. Mm-hmm. Okay? Mm-hmm. The generation coming behind that is not as hungry.
Right.
And they've been, if you would ask in the 80s how many people had artwork on their walls, 10 people, one person would say it. Now it's totally inverted. You'd be lucky if you could find one person don't have artwork in the house. Mm-hmm. Okay. But what happens is we get jaded. Now if you can, if you don't know what jaded means, because I know all of us speak different languages. Remember when Obama went into office and how proud y'all felt?
Yeah.
Well, if you look at where you're at now, you may find you might be a little jaded. Because you've accepted that change, you've adapted to that change, and you're looking for what's forward. Well, the same thing happens with what we're doing. You know? So our job is not hard, because the artists are everywhere. How connected are you to your culture is the question. You know, because when you come and listen to this music, same thing. If it wasn't for you guys, the whole smooth jazz format wouldn't exist.
That's right.
Because the jazz performers, y'all let them get away. Y'all wasn't ready. You appreciate them now, but at that time, you didn't have the luxury of it. People outside of the country did. If it wasn't for their international support, they wouldn't have made it. We call them legends now. So we are in that same time. We still have a personal responsibility to uphold our culture. And whatever way you do that, through supporting things like this, whether supporting the artists, or whatever you see, I mean, if y'all took all your cars, all your outfits, and your houses, and all those material things you have, and you divide them and make a pile of all the things that are culturally representative of who you are, you might find out where you really are. Amen.
He's talking about being the gatekeeper of culture. Now we're going to get into the value of the artwork, because while we're the gatekeepers of culture, we've also have years behind us that has allowed our artwork to have value, monetary value, and appreciative values. But before we go there, Charles, I want you to add on to what my brother was just talking about.
Okay, well, everything that we've spoke about so far is very relevant. But I came from a different understanding of my purpose, and I knew enough, they taught me enough in corporate America that there is no excuses for success. Regardless of what happens out there, what drives you to buy what you buy, there is a larger reason for that. So one of the things that we did, my company took a responsibility to educate, so we came up with this magazine called Images, which represented probably 3,000 or 4,000 self-validating artists throughout the country. And we did this magazine for 8 years. And the purpose of that were my contemporary peers would put ads in this magazine, and we would distribute it to all art lovers throughout the United States. When we finally folded, our prescription level was about 15,000 throughout the United States. And that's a good number of people who are dedicated to collecting art. So we went to major trade shows and put on these. I created a company called Black Art on Tour, okay, where we took attention of artists and we went out throughout the United States doing these major trade shows. And believe me, we also did studies. We did studies on art and found out that $55 billion were spent on art in general every year. Of that 55,000, we represented $5 billion a year in African spenders of African-American art. A lot of you, it's hard to imagine what $1 billion is in expenditure, okay? To carve out a niche in $5 billion was a challenge, but we were able to do it. $5 billion a year in sales. So we went even further than that. We said that we were going to beat this game. And we knew that those planes hitting those buildings in New York was going to have a major impact on what that disposable income. But here's the thing. There's one thing that we had to understand. We had to understand you and your reasons for buying. Okay, because we knew that art is something that you really didn't need, because it can't feed you, it can't put shelter over your head, you can't drive it. So, but it also satisfied another absolute need, and that's pride and who you are. So we started paying attention to that, regardless of all the other things that were going against us. The last bastions of blatant racism is in the arts. The system that sets up who makes it to the top systematically leaves out African-American artists. We almost have to build and make our own art form, like rap. People thought it was an urban thing and it would never catch on. I went to Japan and saw Japanese youth doing rap. It really sounded funny, but the fact that it had spread that fast, and now it's become a natural art form. And the thing about art forms, if it makes an economic impact, what I mean by that, it hires people. Okay, it has an economic industry, then it gets respect, just like the movie industry. Just like actors, just like spoken word artists, and I mean the rap artists. Spoken word hasn't quite made it yet. Just like visual artists haven't quite made it yet, because we haven't organized it into an institution that demands hiring corporations to support it, nonprofits to invest in it. It hasn't happened yet, but once that happens, I know that from my heart, that it will become a part of the fabric of our artistic appetite, and it becomes necessary, just like all of you that come on a jazz cruise, just to be close and intimate with famous entertainers. There's going to come a day when we reach that plateau for visual artists, but like I said, it's institutionalized. You got a lot of corporate money coming into music, to the music industry, that supports that. You don't have that in the visual artists. All right. And this is the things that we're working on very hard to achieve. So I think at one time in this discussion, we're going to have to get them involved and ask questions.
Yeah.
Because I can see that you're just on the edge.
Yeah.
Okay?
Because there's so many angles. There's probably a lot of things that we could talk about that we need probably for you to ask us a question. But, you know, I know now, you see the galleries, there's not enough museums and galleries for the number of artists that exist. So out of that, artists like ourselves who have a passion with this thing, you know, what are we gonna do? So you just heard that something else was born out of not having accessibility. Listen, museums, they reproduce work. They sell postcards and posters, you know, but once you go through that channel, that's the channel that they invest in, want you to invest in, so they're going to protect it. Just recently, or more relatively recent, there's a auction house, right? What's the name of that auction house?
Sotheby's.
No, the other one.
Christie's.
There's one more.
The one that had my hands
moved up. No, the one that just put some of James Denmark work. I forgot the name of it, but anyhow, for many, many years, they would not entertain African-American art, right? Until someone purchased one of Bearden's work, I think for more than like $350,000.
Listen to that number now.
Yeah.
They will not even look at work that they can't sell for $300,000 or $500,000 and up. So
But before then, they didn't think you guys, our black people, valued their art and their culture, not only from a cultural perspective, but from an investment perspective, right? And as a result of seeing African-Americans who are interested in collecting art from an investment purposes, they have just added an African-American, aspect of an art towards their auctioning. That's telling. You know who did that? You did. We made that investment accessible. Now imagine if we had our own auction house. There is supposed to be one African-American auction house, but we don't know about her. I'm still trying to remember her name, and I think her value is less than 300, you see. So we, in a sense, can create the value and create the appreciative value that we seek just by being deliberate in supporting the art. And I think you wanted to say something about the auction house?
Yeah, that whole thing, I mean, I don't know if we're speaking about something that you guys are aware or not aware of. For years, our master's works were not in auction houses. And over the last 10 years, they began to make it to the auction houses. The most recent collection that went to the auction was Maya Angelou's collection of works.
Wow.
I mean, she had a few pieces in there, a couple of her contemporaries.
Two of my pieces in there.
Exactly. A couple of Romare Bearden's. But you heard that number, he said, 350,000. The counterparts are in the millions, several million. Mm-hmm. That's how far away we are. So even if you say, okay, the validity of this thing is what's happening in the museums, if you can imagine that whole industry right now is currently keeping the price of our master's works, mm-hmm. talking about Elizabeth Catlett, Jacob Lawrence, Charles White, they're keeping those down low mm-hmm. so they can do what?
Make money.
Acquire them.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So it's happening while we're speaking, but it's happening very, very slow. Mm-hmm. Okay? So pay attention when you hear about these things going to auction, because you'd be surprised some of the things. If you're not sure, how many of you here now are participating in buying on auctions online? That's my biggest tip to all of you. Go online, join up with these auction houses, Sotheby's, look at all the auction houses, join up. You just put, they do all the stuff online now. Make a username, password, and then they will email you, let you know when certain things are going up for auction. You'd be surprised what you can acquire in that medium. Yes, ma'am.
I was saying to you, rolling by my road the other day, there was a little shop or an auction on the boat.
That's a real good question. When are they going to start? She said today do auctions on the ships, and they were wondering why they haven't taken the time to start including our works in those auctions. I will tell you that is going to be changing soon. And without becoming too political, there is one main company that does the art for all of the ships. And they determine what's in it and what's out of it. And I'll leave it by saying that they have chosen to not purchase our work.
Right.
I'll leave it there. So that's another reason why us being here is a very important move. Because again, that helps them to put, when we started in this thing, the same galleries that began to buy our work didn't want to buy our work. They had the choice to start ordering our work to supply to their customers or not. I can tell you the or not didn't last very long. Okay, so the demand really does begin to change that.
I'm going to say something about the Capital Jazz. They have accomplished something very important. There's a company here called Park West, and they're not here during this cruise. And I've never seen that on a cruise ship ever before. So we we should be thankful that the Capital Jazz Cruise had the foresight to say that we, and it says, you know, Phil, take yourself and represent. While you got this opportunity, represent. I hope he took my advice. But what I want to say about our future is pretty bright, okay? And this whole thing about Christie's and Sotheby's, you know, they're going to continue to do what they're going to follow the billions of dollars that these billionaires, when they buy art, they turn them over to museums, they turn them over to Christie's. If you walk into museums, museums don't own art, they're caretakers.
Right.
So everything belongs to a fund or foundation or private collection. So to get into there, you got to have to get people to buy African American arts to get into museums.
Exactly.
So that's a given. That's their thing. Me as a self-validating artist, I look at what's happening. Okay, I saw this thing on TV last night with the fashions, all these people are doing now. Take that. Pay close attention. They're getting into a art form that was left. They wasn't in that art form for a long time, and they have knocked down the walls, okay, and said we're going to do this. And I'm saying that we have to applaud them. What they did, these were ex-rappers, so to speak, okay, and they have changed the buying habits of a generation of young people. And it's all about doing what you feel in your heart. I mean, some of the things I see them wearing, I says, my God, but it's trendy, okay? Now, art is trendy too. So what do you do? You gotta find out, I gotta find out what you want. We don't have any more galleries to speak of by economic reasons, but that doesn't mean you went away. So how do we find you, okay? Social media. I'm telling you, Macy's just closed 15 stores and haven't skipped a beat. Why? It's because they fall in the trends of Amazon. Okay? So with me, if I'm coming on the cruise, I'm not looking for you to buy my art. You know what I'm looking for? I'm looking for you to sign up so I can have a continued relationship with you. I want your emails. Okay, so that I can tell you at any given time what I have to offer to you. That's how we build relationships. That's how we build network. We use what is trending in our society. Nothing's going to change that. We ain't going to go backwards. So you have to grab on to what's trending. And social media is trending. Now we have access to 8 billion people on social media, and that's the population of the world. Now, if any of us, I don't care what you're selling, cannot find a marketing niche out of $8 billion, 8 billion people, there's something wrong with you. You're doing something wrong. So if I had 5,000 people that I know, I met and shook hands with, and looked you straight in the eye, and you said you love my work, what else do I need? A gallery, if I'm lucky, if I sign up with a gallery and he's going to take 50% of whatever I make, okay, and we have a reception and 100 people show up at that reception, do you realize that I can have a reception online to 10,000 people at any given time with just a flick of a key on my computer pad? That's how profound things are changing in our society and how you sell. Okay, this is how we're going to win. Okay, we cannot think about and do things the way it was done yesterday. We have to change our mindset and go into what's trending. When Ford came up with the idea of the automobile, what did he say? He was going to make the automobile what? Affordable, because he wanted every household in America to own one. That is a marketing genius. So if I'm going to sell my art, I want every black person in America to own one. How am I gonna do that? Follow whatever is trending. Because this country does everything to save us what? Time. If you wanna buy a pair of shoes, you have to first decide you wanna buy a pair of shoes. Then you have to go outside, start up the car, drive down to the shopping mall. Then you have to search for the shoes. Then you buy the shoes and you have to go home. How many hours have you wasted for one pair of shoes? You could have been playing golf if you had just went on the internet and clicked buy the shoes, and the shoes would have been there at your doorstep the next day. Then, see, anytime this country invents something that saves you time, it's gonna catch on like wildfire. Listen to me. I don't care what you're selling. You can be many millionaires if you do it right. Now, I can still say that whatever happens, okay, I still can pick up my phone and call you. I can still pick up my computers and send any message to any of my collectors at any given time. When you sign my book, you better believe you're gonna hear from me. And that's what I train young artists. I don't train them how to be famous. Forget fame, success. Because if you pursue fame, somebody's gonna be always trying to pull you down and get on top of the hill. That's what fame is. Fame is only short-lived. Football players have a five-year life as a football player. They're gonna get hurt, and then there's always young football players there to take their place. I don't want that. I wanna be successful for a long period so that I can satisfy the desires for most of my people. And the only way I can do that is listen. Listen to what you want, give it to you, and also find the most economic ways to do that. Okay? This is what we're training a lot of. I have an organization called R2000. Okay? Our main emphasis is to train young artists how to be successful. I've had artists come out of college with not a clue. Got all kind of talent. They don't have a clue where to start because they don't know why. They don't teach that. They don't teach artists how to be successful. So this is the thing that, this is the challenge that we have. We have some amazing young artists, amazing talents. I don't care if they're playing an instrument, painting pictures, amazing talent. We are gifted that way. But we have to train them how to be successful, because all of them are going for fame. And no, nuh-uh. Fame is good if you can make it, but only a few. And that's part of our problem. We got a lot of our youth out there on the streets with all kind of talent because they went for fame and they've been discouraged. So I don't know what you say about that. I would love to open up a dialogue if anybody wants to come by and talk. But this is serious. This is where we are, and we can beat this thing, and we can win.
Okay, I appreciate that, y'all. So right now, in the lieu of time, we're running short on time, so I'm gonna try to get as many questions in as we possibly can. And I have a tidbit that I want to ask you guys to participate in. I think there's a reward at the end of it. And the question is, what does Romare Bearden, right, Billie Holiday, and Billy X. Stein have in common? No, that's too easy. She said jazz. Okay, you were close. But before we go, keep that in mind, but I want to give everybody a chance to ask more questions to us about art, okay? Go ahead.
My question is about the value of art.
My question is about the value of art, and I'll be really quick with this. Many, many years ago, I was in a little boutique, and I saw where it wasn't a print, it was actually a figurine, and it was Annie Lee. I didn't know anything about black art except Jesus and on the walls in my house growing up at the Last Supper, and I saw this figurine and I thought I could relate to it because it looked so much like me. So I bought it. That was the beginning. So now I have a lot of figurines. I have some originals. So how do I value it? Does somebody come in appraise it? Thank you. Does somebody come in? How do I go about that? That's my question.
A lot of you, how many of you now have been collecting for 5 years? That's about 10 years. For about 20 years. Okay, you 10 and 20 years and getting to the point where you were hoarders up to this point.
Right.
Upscale hoarders. But most of you don't have it covered in your insurance at home. So the next important step now, I know you do, I said most of you, I saw a lot of people go like this, so it's not for the ones that do. You have to have the stuff appraised. And that's going to be a challenge because most appraisers don't understand the African-American art market. So with that being said, you can be your own detective, go online, Google your product in the price. Points will show up. You can find ranges of the lowest and the highest. Okay. And you might be able to talk to an appraiser because they're going to do the same thing.
Okay.
Okay.
A lot of us artists who started out many years ago, like me, when I first started out, my work was like $30. You can't even get an original for $30 right now. So those people got a $30 original, guess what? They can resell.
Right.
Okay? So we're going to keep moving real quickly. Next person.
Okay, I quickly want to say I appreciate your stories because I believe in spiritual grounding, and having to hear your history make it feel so much better to have your work in my home.
Thank you.
I appreciate each and every one of you. Thank you
very much. Okay, next person.
If y'all form a line by the microphone, then we can get these questions done rather quickly. Can anybody who has a question come up on this side? Thank you.
My question to you, the three of you, do you have any artwork in the new African American Museum in Washington, D.C.?
Mm. That's unanimous. No.
Next question.
Wow. Let me answer
this. Bibbs is in there.
Have you been asked?
In a roundabout way.
No.
No, I don't.
Thank you for that question,
think,
though. I appreciate that because someone saw some of my pieces and thought that I should have some work in there because, you know, I'm fusing art with history.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'm documenting the civil rights struggle, the blueprint. And I'm doing a show dedicated to Muhammad Ali November 5th coming up. And it's very innovative way of approaching it. It's very solution oriented about how we move forward as a In the time that we're living in, so it would be great to have our work in there, but not yet. I would say not yet.
Okay. Seriously, answer that question with what you said is a definite no. But you have to understand, this is the history of African Americans. So it's going to be, its contents is not going to be solely art, visual art. It's going to be about the history. So when you go to there. I know Lonnie Bunch, and I've talked to him, and he had explained at a conference for ASALA, the Association of African American Life and History. He explained his whole motive, and that is to educate and enlighten the United States about the history of black people. So it doesn't have a concentrated effort on visual arts. But there will be some visual arts in there, but I don't think it's going to be their main thrust, from what I hear from the museum.
I've been to the museum, and they do have a really nice exhibition up there. Okay, the real big issue is that that one building couldn't hold all the visual
artists.
Right.
I understand.
But I can tell you they have a very good cross section of artists in that collection, including some living artists.
Yes.
I mean, Kevin Cole was one. See it.
I think
Fahamu artwork is in there. It's another very well-known artist.
Joy Scott
work is there now, and Danny Simmons. So we're there. Any other questions? We're going to keep it moving quickly.
Yes, I want to know, do you all do any digital art, like through with the iPad or anything like that?
Wow, that's a good question. I've been asked to take interest in that. I know there's an artist now, Najee Dorsey, who's very, very strong in the digital area. I haven't dabbled into that yet, but I know that that's very much being pushed and that's out already. I don't understand how digital, you know, what's, I love my hands in it. I love building and taking acrylics and stones and gels and mediums and know that it came through me that way. The digital is so disconnecting for me. You could do some amazing things with it. I've seen it. It's phenomenal. But the actual authenticity and the fact that it actually came from my creation and from through God giving me this inspiration, I'm not ready to lose that right now. I know a lot of you guys, you have books on in digital. I still like to touch books and smell them and open them and read them. Like the books I have. So I'm not opposed to it, but and one guy approached me and said, "Listen, we like to do your work in digital." I said, "How's that work?" I went to Canada and I saw it. I saw a frame and I saw different artwork just popping up, and I'm like, "Where's the original?" "Oh, we don't need that anymore." You can have as many different artwork, and I don't want to lose that space.
You know what I said? Remember what I said about trending? Now this is a perfect example. Now it's been said that in about 30 years, and that's not too far off. I hope I can live long enough to see this. But the artists that are doing art by hand are going to be so specialized. Okay, and when our young people see us doing it by hand, they're gonna be amazed at the fact that we're doing it by hand. The trending that's going now, art is being applied digitally while we speak. And like I said, you cannot change or turn back the hands of time. It's so strong, it's gonna move forward. The only thing that we have to do is grab on for the ride, because that's where the money is going. That's where the influence is going. Don't ever, you know, get in a situation where you become old school, because I still love old school, but that's not what they're playing on the radio now. Okay? So just be cautious of that and just watch what's happening. So it is trending.
I want to add to this. Right now, everybody, to answer your question again, everybody on this stage is participating in digital art in one form or another. Most of us, G Clay technology is digital. And most of us have those in our repertoire. I have some originals out there, and G Clay's out there. You probably couldn't tell the difference between the two. But what I can say is that even though they haven't begun to create digitally, I've been starting to create digitally the last couple of years.
And this is something I'm definitely looking into.
Are y'all still thinking about my question?
Romeo Bearden, Jacob Lawrence, Romeo Bearden and Billy Eckstein and Billy Holiday have in common?
Anybody have the answer to that yet? What'd you say?
That's what I'm
saying.
No.
Next question. Think about it. It's going to be blow your mind when you find out.
Can you, for someone starting out and wanting to collect, can you give tips on what you should buy? Everybody can't buy an original, but there are levels of collections that you can start.
I would say, first of all, you have to visit the galleries or go to come to these artist sites, or spend as much time in galleries and museums and familiarize yourself with the medium. Find out what you like, what resonates to you. That's the first thing. And once you find out what resonates, then you learn about what is that medium, what is that artist using that resonates to you. Start to become, and then you can also talk to artists themselves and gallerists. They will educate you. You know, the more time you spend at galleries and museums, and you talk with gallerists and, you know, museum people, and there are some collectors also that are very informative about what art is. There's some of your own peers who have art, and they've been following us for many years, collecting our art for many years. They're very learned about what
what the mediums are, the little tidbit stories about the artist, and to give you a connect. So when you find an artist that you like, you know, that's the first thing, buy what you love. And then from the love of it will drive you to be just learn so much more about it. That's the first, that's the only thing I can say. Yes.
Are they related?
Huh?
Are they related?
Are
they related?
Okay, she said, are they related? She talking, remember now, the typical question.
What's she talking about?
The typical question is, what does Romeo Bearden, Billie Holiday, and Billy Eckstein have in common? Okay, she said, are they related? And wrong. What's your answer?
Billy Eckstein, I believe, involved himself in design in some ways.
Say it again?
Billy Eckstein involved himself in design in some ways.
Involve himself in design in some way. Wow, did you stay up late last night? You gotta finish that thought. You're in a good area. And wrong. Okay, before we come back to that, next question.
Yeah, I want to answer the question.
The lady that talked about how to collect?
Yes.
Okay, everybody in this room started the same way. They found an open edition they could afford, okay? Then they got cute one day, and they saw these little fractions. Then they started buying limited editions, and more limited editions, and more limited editions, right? Then their house got full.
Right.
Then they found out about originals.
Right.
And then they had to try to figure out which ones they want to take home, down at home.
Right.
And then they started buying originals. So start with what you like, but most likely it's going to be an open edition first, and you'll just work your way up like everybody else. It's not complicated.
And many of y'all can afford originals from the outset. We artists, we pride ourselves in keeping a price range or having artwork in the price range that you seek. So many of us have originals that you could work with. We can offer you payment plans and, you know, we work with you. So, all right, any more questions?
If you were advising an emerging artist.
The sound one.
If you,
she must have turned
it on.
We have a daughter who's an emerging artist. If you were advising, other than the social media, some of the other things to get established, the quote business side, do you have any other thing? And it's a female, and so far most of the people that you've spoken are male. And how does that impact, if I know?
Let me tell you something. It's nothing like mentors. Nothing like having someone that is doing exactly what she wants to do. You know, we all found our own path. You know, I have worked in galleries. I've been, you know, in the gallery that Jacob Lawrence and Ernie Critchlow and Norman Lewis put together. I also have been in group shows. But, you know, I found this path where I'm straddling the fence. You know, sometimes I have work in the galleries and museums, and sometimes, you know, most of the time I'm selling my work myself. So she has to find a path, but the first thing, she has to create a body of work that, find her niche with it, and let that work find its audience. Because I started in 1984. It wasn't until 1979, after I saw Bearden and Lawrence's work, where those works inspired me to look at my own life story. And then they gave my art its own voice. And I realized I had a connection with so many people. And that relationship has been building and continuing for a lot of years. So the artwork has to kind of sell itself. You know what I'm saying? So tell her, do 10 pieces. Show different people. And let her look at the feedback on which, if they pick five, then take those fives, retire the other five, and do five more. Until she have a body of work where she knows that it's coming from her, but it's also a connection. The dialogue, an ongoing conversation can be had. And then that's marketing. This is one-on-one right here. This man, these two could tell you about that. And let her accept it. In the meantime, finish school?
She finished
school already? What? She wants to do it for herself?
She wants to be an artist. I mean, she's doing it, but you know, you've got to do it so that you're eating, and she's eating it.
She got to find it. Listen, I was blessed to find my niche. them silhouetted long neck figures with no eyes or nose, and that southern background was very, very much in the same family as Bearden and Lawrence. I started to tell my own southern story. You know, prior to, like I said earlier, coming out of the South, being southern was looked frowned upon. But after I saw Romeo Bearden's work, he made black seem like a southern and black being a beautiful thing to be. And so I was able to embrace that. It became life transforming. So when people feel that resonation and feel that power, that life transforming power in you, it's gonna spill out. And so more and more people are connected to it now. Even to the point where I'm not only still keeping that theme alive, but I'm putting the history in there and affirmations in there. Very relevant, very pertinent to where we are right now, being deliberately and unapologetic and authentic, you know? So I have been able to trend, you know, keep going and evolve and keep that relationship going. So she has to find her niche, you know?
Is she a millennial?
Yes.
Okay. I can tell you most millennials don't work enough. Don't be fooled by what we say. We are cranking out a lot of work. We produce, our work ethic is, most students that are millennials that come to my studio, they have to go home and sleep for 2 nights because they can't believe the amount of work that I'm doing. So first she has to work, and like he said, the body work is important. Second thing is the creator didn't design make us to create for ourselves. And she has to share by any means necessary and not be so forced by the whole thing of making money.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And this whole thing of eating, because you used the word eating a couple times.
I said it. That's not her issue.
But I'm already helping you, because if you're saying it, you're part of the problem. Mm-hmm. See, we create that. You got to eat off of it. You got to eat from it. We create an old school vibe with this level of creativity that's quite dangerous. And even though you might be saying it kindly and buying her stuff, when that's planted in here from the parents, even in passing conversation,
right,
it's a validation to them until they see something else. So part of it, I tell all parents, I make parents leave my studio when they drop their kids off. And when their kids are with me, I start to erase that connection of that expectation that we build in our kids when it comes to being musicians, dancers, or artists. So remember now, it starts from your level of support. Okay. Why? No. I'm not picking you apart. I'm just saying that if you're concerned about her eating, you have to now begin to change that dialogue into something that's going to make her be more creative.
Hello. We're not supposed to be in one accord on every issue, so I'm gonna voice something entirely different about this issue. Your child went to college. She studied art. Now, she wouldn't have done that if she felt that she couldn't make a living at it. So then it gets boiled down to the practical application of her skills to the public, and in turn get fed. If there's a break in that, I guess I'll tell you what's going to happen. She's going to change your occupation, become a doctor or something, a lawyer. I've seen it happen. But you can be very discouraged if they don't understand how they fit in that market. This is a market just like anything else, selling cars, shoes, and everything. Don't be fooled by this whole thing about art, that is a glorious thing that only a few people can do and only a few people can enjoy its benefits. There has got to be a practical approach to it. Now, what I said earlier, they taught her how to paint and draw, but they didn't tell her how to survive. So where do you get that? Where do you go get that? Well, you go to your peers and find and talk to them and tell them how they did it. Or you go to a school and take business. Business 101, I don't care. Art is a commodity to be sold on the open market for what? Money, bottom line. You know, keep it straight and keep it making sense to whatever thing else that goes in our society. That way you'll never starve a day in your life and never want for anything. So the art is a skill. You make a product with the skill, okay? for so long, back in the 60s, Beard and them, you know, they did their thing, okay? And the problem is, we haven't moved from that. We're still looking at them as an example of what we do in today's society. I keep going back. Listeners, they got a different attitude, but they still wanna eat.
But to add to what he's saying, what these brothers are saying, you have to know, let me tell you something. Every artist ain't supposed to be doing business with his art. There's some people supposed to let somebody else do that because that's their strength. Your strength might not be selling your own work like we are. We have that passion. Somehow that's in our DNA. That might not be in her DNA. So you don't push somebody to be in business because they have a product. They may not be the right person for it.
Now you done started something.
All right now. Because that's the way it is. All of us don't know. Some people should never do business.
Here's the thing. We don't have those people out there to do the business for us anymore. Galleries are closing. And you know why they're closing? Because you don't support them anymore. Because you got social media. I'm telling you. It's happening. Okay, I'm gonna make a prediction right here today. In 20 years, if you have a gallery in your community selling art, you're gonna be fortunate. Because it's not gonna happen. Because if all the artists understand how to sell online, okay, they're gonna win. You know why? Because they don't have to share the profits. Now, when it comes down to the basic concept of survival in this country, listen very carefully. There's very subtle changes that are happening constantly. If you don't stay in line, you're gonna be left out, I'm telling you. And it's true, I've seen it, you've seen it happen. You've seen what's happening in our society, okay? It's no joke, but it's all for the better, okay? We are still the biggest country in the world. Why? It's because we're the most technically advanced company in the world. I mean, country in the world, okay? Don't forget that. We're still the greatest. Don't believe what Trump tell you.
She needs an entrepreneurial class, if that's where she's at. And he's right about the world, because I just did a creative workshop for 120 disadvantaged girls in Turkey through the government. So my work is what brought me over there. They want me to come back in March. So they love what we are. Our culture is so, you talk about rap. I saw a Turkish kid driving a convertible listening to rap music in Ankara. And they're listening to us. And the reason why they brought me over there, because they liked the way I depicted black women. They were celebrating International Women's Month in Turkey. So I know, we have to know, it's what we have is still valuable. We're still valuable to ourselves. And if we don't talk to your children about the value that someone else will take and use so that you can own your own value and market your own value, you have to instill that. You gotta take them back to the history. Slavery ain't over for a lot of African Americans. There's still money being made on us on every level. We have to start taking that and making that work for us, especially after the election. Like the pilot says, prepare for impact. By that time, it's too late. Okay.
Hi, I'm almost embarrassed because my question is not deep, but I'm curious.
It's okay.
If I were to walk into your homes,
yes.
What would be the first piece of art that I would see? Would it be one of yours, or is it someone else's, and whose is it?
Wow.
That's the most powerful question I've been asked in 30 years. When you walk into my door, there is a log behind my front door that my father painted of a woman's face with leaves falling down, because he knew I liked fall. And so I keep that right by my door when I walk in.
Wow.
I have a Charlie Palmer, whom I love. And there's so many other artists' work that I don't have, that I want, and I've been close enough to get, but I've been so prolific that you'll see Leroy Campbell.
Yeah, you would have to go pretty far to find my work in my house. He can tell you. I did exhibitions on my collection where I've included and had him come out and speak to people in my local community. But I think it's very important that we, when we start our collections, look at it as a legacy for your own family. Something that you're going to pass down from generation to generation. I told my wife, Elaine, I says, on my birthday, don't buy me no tie, no shoes, anything. Buy me an art by a established artist. I don't know if you know Sonny Bustin. It's probably one of the greatest sculptors in our time. And for about 5 years straight, she bought me a sculpture of Sonny Bustin for about $3,000 or $4,000. Now those same sculptures are selling for $20,000. So white people have been doing this thing for, the source of their wealth is tied up in art.
Exactly. Yes.
Okay, they don't house it in our house like I do. Museums are caring for these collections. When you fill out your will, okay, make sure you include your art. And that's for all of you. You know, find something that you like and maybe collect a series of one artist, because that makes the value of that artist even greater, okay? And then find another artist and do a series. And then document everything and put it and write it down. Document it. Back in Katrina, when Katrina hit, we got inundated with people out of Louisiana. Their collections were totally decimated, okay?
Terrible.
So they were telling me, could you send me a receipt? I told them no, because insurance company they're involved in replacement value.
Right.
So if something you bought for $100 and then 20 years later it gets damaged, you don't take that receipt and says, it ain't gonna work. Okay, it's replacement. Remember, replacement value. So that one piece of artwork could be worth $4,000 or $5,000. So just remember that. That's very critical. We're still receiving calls. I still receive calls from people who've lost their something in their collection. And that's what we do. We can give an estimate of the value and sign that. And that's good enough for your insurance company.
Excellent.
Okay. We got one more question. We got to cut it off right now. Just take a few minutes and let's deal with this tidbit question. This should be the fun part, okay? So, go.
They are related by artistry.
They are related by artistry.
All
she's close. She's in the ballpark. Went wrong. Who else have the answer? What is that? Romeo Bearden, Billie Holiday's a jazz cruise, and Jake and Billy Eckstein have in common. Your answer?
They have the same birthday.
She said birthdays. Wrong. Come on, let's go. Come on, somebody know.
I'm not sure if I'm right.
It doesn't matter.
Are they all amateur artists? Or
very close. Stay where she is. Come on, let's move it around. Wrong.
They all did something with strange fruits.
Wrong, but closer. Stay where she's at.
They all did God bless the child.
No, you're doing the same thing she's doing. Wrong. Come on, somebody else. Who else? Yes.
They based
anything
on art on Tahiti?
Huh? Very good, but wrong. Next. Come on, let's go. Anybody else? Y'all give up?
Yeah, they all have either a song or art piece of the same name.
Very close.
Name straight fruit.
No. Anybody else? This is going to blow y'all mind. Yo, brother, you know it.
They had a subject around Billie Holiday
was
singing, but they all had a subject around a certain
part. Ooh, she was almost like in there. You ain't there. You ain't went all the way over, but you almost there.
They all had a relationship with Harlem.
That's nice. I mean, that's not the right answer.
They were awesome.
Anybody else?
Yeah.
Y'all, when y'all give up, I'll tell you the answer. The brother back there. I gotta hurry up, she says. No. Okay, it's the last chance.
They all had something to do with modern Renaissance?
No.
They're all musicians.
This is amazing when I discovered this. You want to answer?
Yes.
Okay. Romare Bearden, the artist, composed music for Billie Holiday and Billy Eckstein. Romare Bearden, the artist, wrote music, songs for both artists.
Didn't know that.
Jazz Cruise, and we talking about. Thank you so much, you guys. It's been great. I hope that we've done as best as we could. Thank you so much. We'll see you out front.
Thank you.
Okay, go that way.